I've been physically attacked after hours to the point where the police had to be called. It makes you feel not safe in your job.
If we haven't got people to look after their health, then you're going to pay a lot more in the grocery store for your beef or your lamb.
The last thing she said to me when she hung up was, "I love you, Dad."
The vet industry is in crisis.
While it's a dream career for many,
a lot of them are burning out, leaving the industry, and in some cases, dying. And yet Australia loves its animals. We have one of the highest rates of pet ownership in the world. And with as many cattle as people, livestock is a big part of our economy. I've come to regional New South Wales to see how this is all unraveled, how abuse from clients to financial troubles have become commonplace, and what could happen if nothing changes. Hi, Tess.
Hello, how are you going?
Good, good, nice to meet you.
You too. I've been running the clinic for 2 financial years. My old boss, who I purchased the clinic from, he retired. We haven't been able to replace him yet, so we went from 3 vets down to 2 vets. With the decrease in vets and then the increase in people with pets, it's been, we've been very, very busy. You can be in here for 14 hours a day. Like if you've got hospital patients, you're coming in Saturday, Sunday, so you can spend your whole day here on the weekend as well.
Outside of the clinic, Tess has a young family and is on parental leave.
I'm at home with the kids and someone calls. You can't just run out. I've got to organise my mum or my in-laws to come and look after them. Long term, it's not sustainable.
This might sound like a run of bad coincidences, but it's a common story for country vets. With the clinic in the next town shutting down, Tess takes on the overflow. Unless it's an emergency, her clinic is now turning away new clients.
Feels horrible. You become a vet because you love animals and you want to help them. It really is starting to take its toll.
You're right. That's not very good, is it?
As long as I can remember, I've always wanted to be a vet. My cousin, he's a vet, and that must have kind of planted the seed. There was no real second backup plan. But the best thing is, I guess, having a sick animal and being able to send it home.
Australia saw a boom in pet ownership during the pandemic. We now have more pets than people, and only 15,000 vets. So the demand has increased dramatically. But vets often start their careers with large hex debts. Their degrees can take between 5 and 8 years and cost between $60,000 and $100,000.
When I left uni, I came out with a $100,000 hex debt. I've been out 11 years. I have about $20,000 to go.
And then there are the setup costs.
This is our very brand new X-ray reader. The reader was $40,000. So the ultrasound was $80,000. You've got to protect this nearly with your life. Very expensive. We have about $70,000 owing from client debts.
Vet visits can cost $80 to $100 and surgery can cost thousands. And there are no subsidies. More pets and a cost of living crisis means vet debt is not that unusual.
I've had to take a huge pay cut since buying the clinic because we want it to be a business that is successful. If we had no money owing, it might mean that I could get paid a little bit more, or I could be paying my vets more, which means that then they're able to bring more vets to the area.
Tess says in emergency situations, sometimes people don't have money on them and they don't come back to pay.
It makes you personally feel like they don't see that you're worthwhile. They don't think that the effort that you put in or the knowledge that you have is worth paying. I've been physically attacked after hours to the point where the police had to be called, and it makes you feel not safe in your job. When you're in those situations, I get to the point and I think, why am I doing this? You know, I'm missing out on time with friends and family. I've had times when I've spoken to my partner where I've just got home and I've gone, I don't want to do this anymore. Let's sell it. This isn't worth it.
The other clinic in Forbes is run by Patty Paul. She's been a vet there for more than 30 years and says the crisis is escalating.
We've been advertising for another veterinarian for just under 3 years and have had very few applicants. We're spending at least 12 hours a day here on a regular basis.
I just had a knock.
Honey, I'm so sorry, but I need to x-ray Scruffy.
Okay.
We're just pausing the interview so she can attend to that.
What did he do when he went out for his walk today? How today is running is probably pretty normal. In fact, this is probably quiet compared to what it can be.
What did I do yesterday? Look at your tummy.
Her work demands are so high, she's had to make other sacrifices.
I actually need to go and have a double knee replacement. And it's very difficult for me to commit to taking the time off for an adequate recovery time. In the meantime, I have to walk on crutches and live with a bit of pain. Actually, yeah, probably just let the squeeze off a bit.
Regional vets play a big role in our food security by making sure livestock are healthy.
If we haven't got people to look after their health, then you're going to pay a lot more in the grocery store for your beef or your lamb.
It can be heartbreaking to have to turn away someone who is in genuine need, knowing that we are the closest veterinarian. They may then have to travel an hour and a half to get to see another veterinarian.
Shortages, financial strain, abuse, and a boom in pet ownership are all adding up for those in the industry.
This crisis is unfolding across the country. I'm on my way to meet a family in Adelaide, and this is going to be a really tough conversation.
Hello.
Hello. Sophie was completely passionate about being a vet.
She was really a bit of a dynamo. If she took something up, she did it with great gusto. I spoke with Sophie on the Monday night before she took her life after she'd been abused, and she was distraught. And I said to Sophie, let it go, let it go. And in fact, the last thing she said to me when she hung up was, I love you, Dad. And for some reason or other, I thought she really meant it.
Gary and Kate lost their daughter Sophie to suicide in September 2021 after the pressures of the industry and client abuse became too much.
A lot of the issues that we're hearing now from the vet community, Sophie did actually talk about that. I thought it was really important that we help out her colleagues.
Gary and Kate have started a not-for-profit called Sophie's Legacy, aimed at reducing the high suicide rate in the industry. Their first step is tackling client abuse. They've sent these posters out to more than 4,000 clinics.
The Sophie's Legacy for us is something that's bittersweet. You know, it's bitter because we've had to lose Sophie. In some respects, it's sweet now because we're working with and helping do Sophie's work while she's not here.
Everyone I've talked to seems to agree, it's a mess. On average, 750 vet graduates enter the industry each year. So, what would it take to turn things around for them?
Perhaps the government can look at how they can help absorb some of their HECS debts if they choose to locate in a regional or rural community.
If we don't see any changes in the vet shortages, we're going to see a rise in veterinary costs, and we're going to see a rise in the cost of meat production, of wool production, of dairy. And that's, you know, that's going to affect everyone, not just people that have pets. At the end of the day, we are still people. We might make mistakes because we've been here all night and we've been working 7 days in a row. If we can't get your animal in, don't abuse us.
You've got to have better working conditions, better pay. I remember so many jobs that Sophie went to, she'd be told, no, you'll do one weekend in four. She worked every weekend. It just crucifies them.